quarterback and not just a toy or just a point of interest. It's more people taking you for real.
Doug, again, congratulations. But how did your teammates react to your selection? That had to be exciting.
They really seemed to be happy for me. We had six guys make it, and everyone's happy for all the individuals that made it. And it seemed like they were happy for me to take that step.
Doug, tell me the feeling. I know quarterbacks don't like to talk about money, but the things that you missed from not being the star that I think you should have been in this league, do you harbor any sense of resentment about those years missed?
Not really. I thoroughly enjoyed myself playing in Canada. Okay, dollars-wise, you know, if I had been doing the things I'm doing this year all along, yeah, obviously I would have made a lot more money and things like that. But I've thoroughly enjoyed my years in Canada, and I don't second-guess those years at all. I had a great time. I played some good football and made a decent living at it.
Doug, in Canada, you were part of championship teams. You know what happens to championship teams late in seasons. They start to come together. Do you sense a coming together with this Bills team right now?
It really feels that way. We've been playing our best football the last few weeks. You know, the games that we've lost, we've been right there. So it's just it's a matter of putting it all together come playoff time, and things are building and going in the right direction offensively and defensively. So this is a big test for us. This week against the Jets will let us know where we stand against the best.
In the feel-good comeback year of the veteran quarterback, you fit every category, Doug. Congratulations and continued success.
Thanks a lot, guys. Appreciate
it. Good job, Doug.
Thanks.
Now time for the four wide receiver selections in the AFC. The NFC has always been a tough wide receiver selection category. This one's getting tough as well. Eddie Mack, Ed McCaffrey. First Pro Bowl, leads the AFC in touchdown catches with 10.
Yeah, 10 TDs out of 58 receptions, so he has been a clutch receiver for John Elway as well as Bubby Brister when they have had to have it. A very tough receiver, big, and a lot quicker than defensive backs give him credit for.
The old giant goes to the Pro Bowl. Jimmy Smith, a return man to the Pro Bowl, second straight 1,000-yard season.
Well, another unbelievable year with already 1,100 yards receiving with two games remaining. If he keeps at this pace and stays healthy, his stats will be mind-boggling at the end of his career. Sure helps having a quarterback named Brunell, though, throwing you the football in a system tailor-made for producing great receivers.
Keyshawn Johnson, one of the reserves, the only number one overall draft pick of the 90s to go to the 99 Pro Bowl.
When you start talking about Keyshawn Johnson, it begins with his toughness running across the middle of the field. He's willing to take a hit. He's willing to run into traffic to make a catch. And I think that's something that a lot of people did not know about Keyshawn Johnson when he came out of USC. He's an outstanding deep receiver as well, long, and his hands are getting better all the time.
Another member of the wide receiver class of 96, Eric Moles, makes his Pro Bowl debut.
Well, he surprised everyone this year, including myself. What has set him apart is how he runs after he catches the football. He averages an unbelievable 47 yards on 8 touchdowns. Eric Moles has made a name for himself, and I'll tell you what, it's good to see him up there with the elite.
This is a very tough position to crack into. That's also the story for the tight ends. There aren't many challengers, but the two at the top would be at the Pro Bowl, even if this was chock full of good players. Shannon Sharp, 7th straight Pro Bowl, first tight end ever, 7 straight 50-plus catch season.
Part wide receiver, part tight end, presents a lot of problems for defensive coordinators when they're trying to figure out where he's going to be in the formation and how he's going to be used, and yet I think he doesn't get nearly enough credit for his blocking at the line of scrimmage. He is really a tight end when it comes to that.
Ben Coates came on strong in the second half of the year. 50-plus catches, 6-plus touchdowns for 6 straight seasons, 5th Pro Bowl in a row.
Yeah, he's a huge tight end that pretty much can do it all. When you're a quarterback in trouble, you always need that special someone to come through in the clutch for you, and Ben Coates has been that man. He's Drew Bledsoe's go-to guy from the day he arrived in New England.
Well, Jim, we saw, you mentioned Drew Bledsoe, we saw the quarterbacks earlier. When we look at the omissions in the AFC, that's the position where it jumps out to me the most. Drew Bledsoe, one of the guys not going back to the Pro Bowl.
That surprised me. I mean, all the three quarterbacks ahead of him definitely deserve it. But you look at a guy like Drew Bledsoe and the stats that he's had, and some of the things he had to go through. Number one, not having Curtis Martin in his backfield. Everybody wanted to look and see what direction Drew Bledsoe was going to go. Unbelievable season. Broken finger, pulled his team back. When a lot of people thought that he was done, didn't think he could come back in the fourth quarter. Drew Bledsoe showed a lot of guts this year, and it's hard to pick. Should he or shouldn't he go?
Two great fourth quarter comebacks, emerged as a leader on that team, over 3,600 yards, but he and Mark Brunell not selected to the Pro Bowl, although they may be their team's offensive MVPs. Tommy, we talked about the wide receiver spot. Man, there is talent at this position.
Well, you talk about Eddie McCaffrey and Eric Mulls and Keyshawn Johnson. These guys going to the Pro Bowl for their first year, along with Jimmy Smith, a second repeater as a second Pro Bowler. Now, we talked about that NFC group of wide receivers as always being the hardest group to break into. When you look at this group and how young these guys are, this will be a group for years to come that will be very difficult to crack into.
Keenan McCardell, Carl Pickens, Joey Galloway, who may be the best physical tools wide receiver of the bunch.
Yes.
Wayne Corbett over 1,000 yards, along with Tim Brown. Those guys, not selected.
I'll take them.
On any team, any day of the week. The wide receiver position with the AFC may be among the best. When we come back, let's see. Elway's going. Shannon Sharpe's going. Eddie Mack's going. Do you think Terrell Davis may have a trip to Hawaii in his future? We'll check out him and the rest of the running backs and O-linemen when you come back. Here's Pro Bowl is 20 years of aloha, the number 20 appropriate to bring up here because going back to Hawaii, a bunch of 20-year-old running backs in the AFC, including Terrell Davis, who has 22 total touchdowns, 21 on the ground, three shy of tying Emmitt Smith's NFL all-time record.
Yeah, and at 1801, he's 199 yards away from that magic 2,000-yard mark, Mike, would make him the fourth NFL rusher in history, joining O.J. Simpson, Barry Sanders, and Eric Dickerson as the only guys to rush for 2,000-plus yards.
Starting with TD, Marshall Faulk went as a rookie, now his third time going 20,090 yards from scrimmage this year.
Well, he's having a Thurman Thomas type of season. I mean, he can do it all. He worked his magic on the ground, as you see here, and through the air. It's not often that you see a running back lead your team in receptions. But the closest guy to him is wide receiver Marvin Harrison with 59 catches. Unbelievable.
The backup running back, Eddie George, third in the AFC in rushing, just four touchdowns, going to his second Pro Bowl, Tom.
Eddie George, that rare, rare combination of speed and size that we so seldom see, standing about 6'3 and a half. Over 230 pounds. He has the speed to get outside, the power to run through people. Here you see him with a nice burst through the hole against the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Outstanding year for Eddie George.
One of the quiet free agent acquisitions. Nod to the captain of the Bills front office and to Sam Gash, picked up from New England, and he outpoints Kimball Anderson, Howard Griffith at the AFC fullback spot. Well, one thing about the AFC is we've seen them take the power away from the NFC over the last season plus. They're running the ball a lot better. Not just a finesse league, but now a power conference as well. And one of the reasons, the offensive linemen. Let's look at the selections headed by Tony Boselli. When Jacksonville made its first franchise draft pick, they picked the right guy in Boselli, going to his third straight Pro Bowl. His career sack number, under a dozen. Tony Boselli has been a factor shutting down some of the best pass-rushing linemen in the AFC. Joining Boselli is Stark. Three other men from the AFC Central, Jonathan Ogden, Bruce Matthews' 11 Pro Bowls, and Dermonte Dawson, his 7th Pro Bowl, the center of the Steelers.
Well, when you think of some of the best centers in the history of the league, the names of Dwight Stevenson, Mike Webster come to mind, but put Dermonte Dawson in with those guys. Pure domination.
Yeah, and the Denver Broncos, the only team with multiple linemen on this Pro Bowl line, Tony Jones and Tom Nalen. So I guess about one lineman per 1,000 yards for Terrell Davis.
On his way to 2K. That rounds out the AFC offense when we come back. On the Pro Bowl selection show, we'll look at the AFC defense. We saw Reuben Brown of the Bills' offensive line. Will Bruce Smith mean a defensive line buddy going to Honolulu with him? Welcome back. We've looked at the offense. Now let's check out the defense that will be representing the AFC in Honolulu in for Sunday in February, starting with Bruce Smith. With Bruce Matthews, 11 Pro Bowls, as many as anyone in the AFC for your old teammate, Jim.
Yeah, that's for sure. And Bruce Smith, he's one of the most respected and feared defensive ends in the game. And offensive game plans revolve around where Smith is. I was always thankful the big number 78 was on my side.
Well, Bruce, a veteran who's starting up on the defensive front. What about a newcomer? Darrell Russell, first Pro Bowl selection, the number 2 overall pick of 97 with big sack numbers.
Yeah, you see the 9 sacks on the season from the interior line, and making the Pro Bowl in your second year, that's very quick for a defensive lineman, and he has, more importantly, been just a dominant front-line man for his defense, an outstanding defense out there in Oakland.
Well, Tommy, joining him on the defensive front, Tim Bowens of Miami, no sacks for the first Dolphin defensive lineman since Jeff Cross in 90 to make the Pro Bowl, and Michael McCrary as well.
Yeah, Michael McCrary of the Ravens, 14 and a half sacks. He was with Michael Sinclair out in Seattle. You can see that wherever he has played, he has been a dominant force.
Time to move on now to the linebackers, and there's so much talent, especially at the inside linebacker spot in the AFC. Somebody deserves going to get left out. Junior Seau deserves to go again and does. His eighth Pro Bowl selection. Chargers have the best run defense in the league, and 55's a part of it.
We didn't have any interceptions, but he's one of the all-time leaders. I mean, Junior's presence in the huddle or in the locker room automatically elevates his team. Where you see the football, you'll see number 55. He thrives on contact.
You see that celebration again. The outside guys, Chad Brown, first Seattle linebacker since Fred Young in 87 to go to the Pro Bowl.
Yeah, and he first showed his skills as a Steeler, but the speed and the quickness to the outside, the ability to rush the passer, you saw the sack totals there. He's a pretty good run defender at the line of scrimmage as well. Chad Brown, a guy excelling at outside linebacker.
The other starter, Mo Lewis of the Jets, the second ever Jet linebacker going to the Pro Bowl. The other, Lance Mell, 1985. Joining them, Ray Lewis of the Ravens and Bill Romanowski of the Broncos.
Yeah, and you start talking about Romanowski. It's been great that he could overcome the spitting incident, the taunting incident of Cordell Stewart in the playoffs and receive the respect of his peers again a year later.
AFC defenses have to be tough because of all the good quarterbacks. We told you about Bledsoe and Brunell left out. Gives you an idea how good the passers are, so the DBs have to be tested on a week-in, week-out basis. Leading the charge, Ty Law, the first New England quarterback cornerback since Raymond Claiborne in 1986 to go to the Pro Bowl.
The New England Patriots are a defense that play a pressing style of defense at the line of scrimmage, and that makes them have to have people who can cover in that secondary, and Ty Law has been a tremendous playmaker for the Patriots over the course of this season, coming up with 8 picks this year.
Also on the corner from the AFC East, Aaron Glenn. The Jets had 4 bowlers in the 90s up until this year. They had 4 Pro Bowlers this year, including Glenn.
Well, Glenn is that type of corner that can cover any opponent's best receiver. Put him in bump and run situations, and a pass has to be perfect. He's the type that would take a chance and usually ends up either an interception or the ball is batted away.
Those are the 2 starting corners. Jim, right back to you on one of the starting safeties. Joining Steve Atwater, Rodney Harrison of the Chargers.
Well, he led his team in tackles last year, probably deserved to be in the Pro Bowl, but he has another stellar year this year, and as a defensive back, not scared to mix it up in the huddle or come up to make a crunching blow in a running back. I mean, pure, fierce guy.
Malloy and Springs, some of the reserves. Well, talk about some of the linebackers who did not go in the AFC. There are a lot of big names, like Lavon Kirkland, like Ted Johnson, injured from New England. And here's Thomas to talk about the Thomases.
Well, certainly we can begin with Derek Thomas, who started his season with 6 sacks. I think that we thought that inevitably he would end up in Hawaii in the Pro Bowl and his team in the playoffs as well. The team didn't have the success that you thought they were going to have, and Derek didn't have the year that you thought he would have. And then Zach Thomas had an outstanding year with the Miami Dolphins, as complete a middle linebacker as you will see, not only in terms of his ability to rush the passer and play in coverage. He has 2 interceptions for TDs amongst his 3 interceptions this year, a guy who I think deserves to be in that Pro Bowl lineup.
Well, you've talked about the Dolphin. The guy that I look at is Terrell Buckley. Every time I see him, he was making plays. I mean, one of the tops in interceptions with 8. Every time that I would see Terrell Buckley, he's either right there making the play, making that tackle, or coming up with a big play. This is one guy that's kind of surprised me that he wasn't there.
You would think if Eric Allen stayed healthy, he may have been one of the corners.
Yes.
Charles Woodson, the Heisman winner, had a great rookie season. Carnell Lake, as good a cornerback, as good a safety as he is, maybe caught in between his
torn
positions.
That's right.
No doubt. He didn't go to the Pro Bowl in 1998. Pretty good offense and defense from the AFC. Next, we have to check out the special teams on both sides, and then the NFC special teams as well. Deion Sanders, he was selected on one or both sides.
Kick. Oh. The line drive. It's got enough distance. It is. Oh, 63 yards! Holy mackerel!
The record-tying kick, one of 74 that Jason Elam has made out of 75 PAT and field goal attempts. That's why the Broncos going to his second Pro Bowl. Craig Hendrick has a Nets punting average near 40. The big-ticket free agent signee paying off with a Pro Bowl appearance. Jermaine Lewis and Benny Thompson represent the Ravens. The special teams coached by Scott O'Brien, perhaps the best return team in all the NFL. 2 Pro Bowlers are rewarded. When we come back, the NFC team will start with the defense. We didn't know if the Minister of Defense was coming back. He's come back towards the top of the sack pile. Going back to Hawaii? Find out after this.
Is presented by...
Now, for the NFC team, we're going to start with the defense. Remember back at the AFC, we talked of Testaverde and Flutie and Elway, the year of comebacks. Well, we didn't know if Reggie White was going to come back to the NFL this year. He does. Leads the league in sacks with 16 and makes a 13th straight Pro Bowl.
And we're glad he did, Mike. Arguably the best defensive lineman we've seen over the course of his long career. That hump move of his is unique to him. And as offensive linemen get bigger, I venture to say we'll never see it again.
He's on the defensive end, one of the starting defensive tackles. Alongside Reggie White will be Warren Sapp of the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, second straight Pro Bowl. 7 sacks really come on, Jim, the second half of the season.
Well, he has, but it's always nice to see a former Miami Hurricane make the Pro Bowl. But this guy always looks like he's having fun, not only playing the game, but ripping running backs and quarterbacks' heads off. And anyone else that crosses his path, he's a pure competitor, as you can see.
Sapp, one starting defensive tackle. The other is John Randall, making his 6th appearance. A man who has never drafted, leads defensive tackles in sacks this decade. Other starter up front, Michael Strahan from the Giants with his 13 sacks. The reserves, Joe Johnson from
Louisville.
And Leon Lett, who had a quiet return back to the Pro Bowl. First time he's there since 1994. And what defensive line for a Pro Bowl could you have without having Reggie White? 13 straight. Reggie, when you talked about possibly not coming back to play this year and you decided to play, people thought, well, maybe he won't be the Reggie White we've come to know. But you've had an even better year this year. Are you surprised at how well your 98 has done?
Well, somewhat. You know, I knew that, as I mentioned before, and all year when I felt that the Lord had spoken to me about coming back, you know, that motivated me to work.
Headlines the NFC spot at linebacker. We speak of Kevin Green, suspended for one game this past week, so he won't add to his sack total this week, but he returns to the Pro Bowl as a Panther.
Yeah, and a super pure pass rusher, Kevin Green, regardless of whether he's with the Rams, the 49ers, or the Carolina Panthers, he produces double-digit sacks every single year. Tremendous outside move. Great Pro Bowler.
With him outside, Derek Brooks, second straight. Tampa Bay Buccaneers represented at linebacker.
We couldn't find anybody else with that many tackles. Wherever the ball is, you're going to find Brooks. It doesn't matter if it's a pass down the sideline, he'll show up in your picture. Pure hustler, and this guy loves to hit people.
Rest of the linebacking core, the man on the inside will be Jesse Tuggle, the starter. Maver, he made his name in this league as a special teamer. He's been in the league a dozen years, 5'11", undersized, going to his 5th Pro Bowl. The reserves, 8th round draft pick Jesse Armstead, and Ed McDaniel, a 5th rounder who has 6 sacks. That's the Pro Bowl linebacking core. The Pro Bowl DBs, are you surprised? Even though he's missed the last 4 games, Deion Sanders will be going back to Hawaii.
Well, it's a 7th Pro Bowl for Deion at cornerback, and I mean, he can do it all. I always had dreams about this guy, not playing defensive back for the Bills, but playing receiver with Andre Reed and James Lawson. This guy, wow. He can do it all. And this, I can tell you one thing, quarterbacks will throw away from him.
That's why you see not a gaudy interception total usually for Deion, but he has come up with 5 picks this year. The starting safety for the NFC, Leroy Butler. Another steady season in what's been an up and down year for the Packers as a team.
Yeah, and what makes Leroy Butler so unique is that he really has a triple effect on an offense. He is a safety, he is a linebacker at the line of scrimmage, and he is the Green Bay Packers' primary blitzer in all their blitzing packages.
His old buddy in the secondary, Eugene Robinson, has moved to Atlanta, but goes back to the Pro Bowl for the 3rd time. And Ray Buchanan of the Falcons goes to his 1st Pro Bowl forever in the 90s. It seemed as though Atlanta had the worst DBs in the league. Their passing stats showed it. This year, 2 Falcons go to the Pro Bowl. Aeneas Williams, Darren Woodson round out the DBs in the NFC. But team success is rewarded, and sometimes team lack of success is also noted in Pro Bowl selection.
Well, there's no doubt. You take, for example, Washington Redskins, 2 guys that come to mind, Chris Dishman and Darryl Green. I know as a quarterback, when you go out on the field, you try to pick on somebody you think you can take advantage of. But when the 2 guys are on the field the same way, boy, you start looking for your tight end and you start looking for your running back.
You know, Tommy, there is one group that is left out of here, and that's the San Francisco 49ers. We didn't mention one 49er player on the defense. I thought we were going to see one in Bryan Young, even though he is hurt.
Glaring omission in Bryan Young. You talk to coaches around this league, and I think more importantly, we who watch the games every single day, we feel the same way. Bryan Young is by far the best overall defensive tackle in the game, and even though you know as a player that he's broken his leg when you make your selection, you still put him on the team, and then you let him not show up, and the next guy comes in and steps in his place.
No Ken Norton, no Lee Woodall, no Merton Hanks, No 49er defensive player. That hasn't happened since 1980 in the Pro Bowl. Pretty amazing. As we come back, we're going to look at a Niner who perhaps did make it. Garrison Hurst had a great Monday night, a record-setting Monday night for the Niners franchise. Good enough to get him in the Pro Bowl. The running backs, the offense, next. Time now to unveil the final unit, the NFC running guys. The running backs and the offensive linemen. You talk running backs in the NFC, you think of two surefire Hall of Famers, Barry Sanders and Emmitt Smith. Well, Barry's in the Pro Bowl again. 10th year, 10th 1,000-yard season, 10 Pro Bowls.
Yes, and 1,355 yards. You see his unique style there. Those numbers great for anybody else, but average for Barry. He just shows you the standard that he set for us over the course of his career.
The other starter joining Barry Sanders in Hawaii, Jamal Anderson, a seventh-round pick out of Utah, now a Pro Bowler, Jim.
Well, he's had a few good years, but here's a guy that not many people knew about before the season started, including myself. But with the year he's having, he may well be the NFC's player of the year, without a doubt in the top three. Plus, he's the main reason the Falcons are 12-2.
Jamal Anderson, Pro Bowler, joining Anderson and Sanders in the backfield in terms of running back, Garrison Hurst, one of two Georgia running backs, Terrell Davis earlier, 198 yards that Monday night game, sealed the deal for him, Tom.
A tremendous straight line runner. Here you see one of his great runs against the New York Jets. This sealed a victory for the San Francisco 49ers. And let's remember, he was an Arizona Cardinal, a Cincinnati Bengal, couldn't make it with those two ball clubs, ends up being a Pro Bowler as a 49er.
The NFC Pro Bowl fullback is Mike Alstott's second straight Pro Bowl. More rushing yards this year, 697, Jim.
Well, if you're running back, you want your fullback to be the guy that puts his body on the line every play. The guy that takes pride in blocking, loves contact, and will take anybody on his path. That's Mike Alstott from head to toe. Not too shabby of a ball carrier either.
And we are joined by the first Falcon running back to be selected to the Pro Bowl since John Settle in 1988. It's Jamal Anderson for the 99 Pro Bowl. Jamal, for you, when you were watching college football, well, playing college football at Utah and watching the NFL and Barry Sanders and Emmitt Smith were running, did you ever think you'd be beside Barry and keeping Emmitt, so to speak, out of playing in the Pro Bowl?
No, and in fact, obviously, it's a dream, number one, to make it to the NFL. And the goal is to try to come in, play as hard as you can, and try to be one of the best players. But, you know, being in a situation where I'm going to be on the same team as Barry, it's going to be something that obviously, you know, you never get used to, but it's going to be a tribute to the offensive line. They did a great job for me this year. And anytime, Mike, you have two guys who got 1,000 yards receiving, a quarterback playing like Chris, the offensive line deserves a tremendous amount of credit.
Well, Jamal, you've had good seasons in the past, but what one thing has propelled you to the point where now people are starting putting your name in there with Barry Sanders and Emmitt Smith?
Well, I think the chance to run the ball consistently. Obviously, with Dan Reeves, I'm getting an opportunity to run 25, 30 times a week, and I'm staying in the game at all times, unless obviously I'm tired. But and that's the thing. I've been able to get in a rhythm and create some things, and with the people that we have here, and like I said, the offensive line and the way Chris has been playing, it's given me an opportunity to kind of open up the offense and do what I like to do, and that's run the ball and run the ball late in the game to secure victories, and that's really helped me out this year.
Jamal, I know the kind of consistency that Dan Reeves brings to practice on a daily basis. How will the team get along without him for the time period until he gets back to practice?
Yeah, well, obviously, Tom, it's a tremendous loss for us. But I think one of the things that Dan did, you know, first and really well was he put together a very competent staff. Rich Brooks is quite capable of leading this team. George Sefcik, our offensive coordinator, and Art Shell, in fact, was a head coach. So the leadership is still there, and that was one of the things that Dan did best.
And, Jamal, in a couple of seconds, tell us how Dan's doing. I know you guys have been asking, and I would guess he's trying to check in on all of you as well.
Exactly. Dan called in this morning. He's doing good, and you know, he's the type of guy, he doesn't want to be away long, and he's probably already faxing in game plans. So we're looking forward to his return, and everything is going well so far.
Well, part of that game plan after 362 carries this year, give it more to Jamal. Congratulations on the Pro Bowl selection.
Thank you very much.
Not in at running back in the NFC, Emmitt Smith, Robert Smith. One of the guys who blocks for Robert Smith leads the offensive line corps. Randall McDaniel. It's time to start talking about him as a future Pro Bowl, not Pro Bowler, but future Hall of Famer. His 10th straight, one of three Viking linemen heading to the Pro Bowl every year since his second in the NFL. Number 64 has gone over to Hawaii. We mentioned the rest of the offensive line. McDaniel a starter. We will check out the rest. It includes Larry Allen, William Roth, Kevin Gogan, Jeff Christie from Minnesota. As we look, Tommy, a couple of Vikings there.
Yeah, Jeff Christie and Todd Stussy is the other to join McDaniel. And Stussy and McDaniel, the left side of that line, where Robert Smith, the running back, does most of his damage, Jim.
Well, I'm staying on the left side because as a quarterback, you want to take care of the people who take care of you. Just ask Troy Aikman, a guy like Larry Allen. That has to take on the opponent's best pass rusher each and every week. Not an easy task for anyone.
Speaking of Aikman, will he be a Pro Bowler in 98? Will Randall Cunningham be a Pro Bowler in 98 with those great offensive linemen kind of keeping the pass rushers out of his way? We'll check out the NFC quarterbacks and the most intrigued, the wide receivers, when you come back. It's official. Dan's 2,000th show.
It was a big night. Everybody wanted a piece of history. I'll remember where I was when Dan hit 2,000. Everybody will.
Sleigh bells ring. Are you listening? In the rain, snow is glistening.
Through the wasteland of winter, the cold wind moans. But the will to win can warm old bones.
Welcome back to the Pro Bowl Selection Show. I think we all agree the most intrigue in the two positions coming up now, the NFC wide receivers and the NFC quarterback. Let's start with the men who throw the ball. No surprise who the starter is. Steve Young, again a Pro Bowler at age 37, seventh straight Pro Bowl. That's the second longest run in team history.
We'll talk about a quarterback that keeps racking up impressive numbers. I mean, Steve continues year in and year out to make the passing game look so easy. But I guess it helps having a receiver trio like Jerry Rice, Terrell Owens, and of course, J.J. Stokes. One guy had a great year. Good job, Southpaw.
Randall Cunningham, three times, as an Eagle. Now as a Minnesota Viking. At the end of the decade, he goes back to the Pro Bowl.
Well, here's a guy that's finally having fun playing the game. His numbers surprised pretty much everyone, but the change in his priorities has turned this once egomaniac into a fun-loving top quarterback that is putting himself and his team at the tops of the charts. Stay tuned for this one.
Randall back to the Pro Bowl, and the other selection, Chris Chandler, one of three ex-Buccaneers who are quarterbacks in the Pro Bowl, 16th first selection.
Chris Chandler, who has never had a completely healthy football season, this 1998 season is as close as he has come to it, and you see the results, not only for himself, but his team as well, and he is certainly happy to finally have made it.
I played real well last year as well, and the team didn't do quite as good as we did this year. And plus, you know, all those guys had great years in front of me, too. So it's a lot of people are deserving of it, and it's very rewarding and such a good feeling to finally get the vote and make it without having to go on a Thursday night and get there late.
That was his other Pro Bowl appearance as an injury reserve. Obviously, no Aikman, no Favre. More on that in a bit. Now the wide receivers. In the early 90s, it was Jerry Rice and Sterling Sharp and Michael Irvin and Andre Rison. They helped make this the toughest position to crack in the entire Pro Bowl. The end of the decade, it's also become a difficult position with headline performances. Pro Bowl starting wide receivers in the NFC, one is a bit of a surprise. Randy Moss, the only rookie selected to the Pro Bowl, the first rookie wide receiver selected since Chris Collinsworth in 1981.
Rookie time. Here's a guy that no one wanted at the beginning of the season. Now he's making some of the smartest head coaches and general managers second-guess their decisions. When he's on the field, this guy's unstoppable.
Joining him as a starter, Antonio Freeman, first Packer wide receiver to the Pro Bowl since Sterling Sharp in 94. 70 catches for Antonio this year. Brett Favre has seen his receiving core hurt, injured, not perform at 100%. But Antonio Freeman has been the one guy to answer the bell on a regular basis to keep the Packers on their playoff path. Freeman and Moss are the starters. As for the reserves, Jerry Rice will go back to the Pro Bowl, missing last year for the first time ever, still going to his 12th, too shy of the all-time record.
Well, what more do we say about Jerry Rice? He leads his conference and catches his 12th selection to the Pro Bowl. And I think that a real tribute to his work ethic, coming back off the knee surgeries from last season and getting back into the Pro Bowl this year.
Jerry going back and Chris Carter going to the Pro Bowl. 9 Vikings making it, including Carter. First time 2 wide receivers from the same team since 93, the Houston Oilers.
The best set of hands in football, I think, bar none. Boomer and I like to say all he does is catch touchdowns, but he catches a lot of other passes as well. And certainly a guy who is used to going to the Pro Bowl along with his counterpart, Randy Moss.
And we are joined by the pair of wide receivers from the Minnesota Vikings to make the Pro Bowl, Chris Carter and Randy Moss. We've seen them in the preseason. We've seen them in commercials. Now we see them as Pro Bowlers. Randy, for everything that you talked about in the offseason and the preseason, what is it like to find out that you are a Pro Bowl starter in your rookie year?
Well, it feels, first of all, it feels good to be in the position, you know, around the type of guys here with the type of players we have on offense to make it to the Pro Bowl. But second of all, I'm not really letting the Pro Bowl distract me and take me away from my focus to try to get to the Super Bowl. So I think, like I told a couple guys earlier about the Super Bowl, I'm not really trying to focus on the Pro Bowl until the Super Bowl is all said and done, if we win or lose before we get there. So I think I'm going to just look at the Pro Bowl and let it dawn on me after the Super Bowl said and done.
Well, Chris, I know everybody's already heard how much Randy has learned from you, but have you learned anything from this rookie?
I mean, it definitely helps the offense. Anytime you can get big plays, 40, 50, 60-yard chunks, it makes it so much easier on the offense, as you would know. And it's easier to score points, and it's easier to maintain the momentum, but it's easier also to game plan because he can do things that offensive coordinators and defensive coordinators don't have a scheme that can stop. And for me, I think it's given me an extra energy to appreciate the game. I see him playing. And the one thing that's impressed me the most about him is there's been not one situation where he's been phased or I see nervous or he looked as if he saw the deer in the headlights the way a lot of rookies do. He's been in a lot of situations and handled them all very well.
Which leads me to the next question, and I ask it of both of you. Collectively, can you two lift your level of play another notch when you get to the playoffs?
I honestly think we can, but not just the two of us. I think just the everybody as a team. Mm-hmm. That they can lift our play up. But like I said all in my interviews throughout the year, that I'll play off this man right here. So when he plays and I know that he's ready, like for instance when he came back last week because the Chicago game he didn't play. So I really knew that he was ready, so we tried to come out there and make it happen even though we didn't really have overall good game, but we played and we won. But like I said, when this guy steps his game up, I think that my energy or I build off of him to make myself better.
Well, if you think back of great Viking veteran receivers, you think of Ahmad Rashad and his career path from Viking wide receiver eventually into television and doing interviews. It's your turn, Chris Carter. We've asked all the questions. I want to see what you're going to ask Randy Moss. Ask him a question for us.
I'm going to show you guys how the pros do it.
Okay. Excuse us. Go ahead. We're ready. Show us.
Okay, Randy, tell me, what was the most exciting moment, given a long year, finishing out, making your first Pro Bowl, and you look back on it and say there was one moment, one defining moment in this year?
I think the most favorable moment is, I think, the second win in Green Bay when we played here at home. Also, we stepped it up, you stepped it up, we all stepped it up as a team to make it happen, to beat a good team for the second time. So I think the Green Bay, the second game we played here in Minnesota in the Metrodome, is the biggest.
Randy, I know Chris has shown you a lot this year. Did he show you much as an interviewer? He didn't show us a thing.
Oh, wow.
Hey, y'all getting on. Y'all getting
hey, Mike.
Man.
Yes, Chris.
Hey, Mike.
Yeah.
I'm all pro at what I do. You're all city at what you do.
With that, I think it's time to say congratulations to you guys.
Hey, we appreciate it.
Congratulations, guys.
And the 7 other Pro Bowlers for the Vikings, as many as the Broncos, top among teams. Randy Moss, Chris Carter, congratulations, guys, and best of luck to you the rest of the way.
Appreciate it.
All right, thank you.
Oh, taking abuse from the Pro Bowlers this year, huh? It was a lot of fun to visit with those guys. A couple of more offensive players we need to present to you on the 99 Pro Bowl team from the NFC. the tight ends. Mark Chmura, third Pro Bowl, three touchdowns in the last couple of weeks have picked up his numbers, the starter at tight end.
Yeah, what any quarterback wants from his tight end is consistency. Mark Chmura, three Pro Bowls in the last 4 years, over 500 yards and catches this year, almost 50 catches. So he is the outlet that Brett Favre uses to keep him safe.
And backing him up, Wesley Wall, the Carolina Panthers. Carolina has two wins this year, but three Pro Bowlers, including Wesley, going for the third straight year. When we come back, we'll hear from Vinny Testaverde and the NFC special teamers. Ryan Mitchell has had another great year, averaging 24 yards per kickoff return, a touchdown for return as well. He returning to the Pro Bowl. Find out next.
The point is, he washed his car a lot.
This is a high floater that Roel Preston would like to return the favor from the goal line. He comes to the 5, to the 10, up the middle, through a hole to the 20, outside, on his feet to the 30. Looks back inside to the 40-yard line, on his feet 45. Could go.
He's going to go.
Week one, that was one of two kickoff returns for touchdown by Roel Preston, who will go as the NFC kick returner only because Deion Sanders was selected as the NFC Pro Bowl kickoff returner, but he also is going as a defensive back. So that trumps the special team pick. Preston, second in the voting, slides up and goes to join Bates and Turk and Gary Anderson as the NFC specialist. Anderson has not missed a kick, PAT, or field goal in 1998.
Inside the Numbers is brought to you by Sprint. With long-distance wireless internet and data services, Sprint connects you to your world.
The 30-somethings, every quarterback selected for the Pro Bowl is in his 30s. The average age of this group, 35.7 years old. Last year's quarterback, their age when they went to the Pro Bowl last year, averaged 29.7. You fans of Pittsburgh and Tennessee and Indianapolis, you have to be patient. It takes a while for these guys to mature and get to the Pro Bowl level. And we're joined by the quarterback of the New York Jets, Vinny Testaverde. Vinny is somebody who has family roots in that New York area. To see what the Jets franchise has gone through over the last 10 years, to see what you've gone through over the last decade plus, this has to be a very rewarding Pro Bowl selection for you.
Oh, this is great, you know, and I think it's a reflection of the players on offense. You know, certainly there's a lot of other guys on our team that are much more rewarding of this than I am, but I was selected and I'm going to go there and try and represent our team the best that I can.
Well, Vinny, your numbers are excellent this year, but one thing that jumps out at me is your interceptions. Only 6. What do you attribute that to?
Well, I think there's a combination of things, Jim. One is that the system is more to my favor, one that I feel very comfortable in, being in my first year. Two, we have so many great players that are making plays, and I think three is that Coach Henning, my quarterback coach, has done a great job of getting us prepared as quarterback each week to go in and have success.
Vinny, what role does Bill Parcells play in a quarterback maturing? We saw it in Phil Simms, we saw it with Drew Bledsoe, Hostetler, all in the Super Bowl. What does he do for a quarterback?
Well, I think he puts the fear of God into you, first of all. You know, because you know if you don't produce for him, you're not going to be around, you're not going to be on his team for very long. So, you know, as a player in general, you need to produce each week, and he's a no-nonsense type of a coach, but he's also a very caring coach of his players, and he wants the same guy to show up every day through practice, through games, and if you can do that for him, you're going to be well-liked by Bill Parcells.
You wrestled the starting job away from Glenn Foley about week 6. Considering that you went through a lot in the league and had to take a lot of things personally and have experienced the ups and downs of football, is it easier for a veteran quarterback who's been around the block to deal with what Parcells is going to give you than maybe a younger quarterback?
Well, I certainly think so. You know, after hearing about his reputation, you kind of have certain ideas coming in, how to handle the situations if they come up. But certainly all the experiences that I've been through have certainly helped me to be successful in helping our team win games this year.
And a win from the division title that could happen Saturday in Buffalo. Vinny, congratulations and thanks for joining us.
Thank you, guys. Thank you very much.
When we come back, one final note from each of our gentlemen about the trip to Hawaii and the Pro Bowl.
Your world, and in part by Schick. Feel the smart design.
Each conference will add a need player, a defensive lineman or a linebacker, but of the selections, Minnesota and the Denver Broncos, 9 for 13.
Well, Denver Broncos placed 9 people on the Pro Bowl team. If you had told them they would win 13 games before they lost one, they would have been satisfied with that. They end up with the one loss, but now they can refocus. The weight has been lifted from them, Jim. They can get ready to go to the playoffs.
One guy I'm looking at didn't make it is Brett Favre. I mean, he had a league lead, well, NFC leading 21 interceptions. That's probably one of the reasons that the players didn't vote him in, but more importantly, 0-3 on primetime, Monday Night Football. That had to hurt.
How about Dallas? Maybe a playoff team. Aikman, Irvin, Emmett don't make the Pro Bowl.
Oh, wow.
Jim Kelly,
amazing.
Tom Jackson, Mike Tirico. Feb 7's the Pro Bowl on ABC. We'll be there all week to cover it. College Hoops next. Good night.
This presentation of the National Football League.
ESPN welcomes you to the following presentation of the National Football League.
Today on NFL Films Presents.
You take care of my face.
I teach these guys to mic me. I ain't gonna say all night. I won't say a thing.
You know, I can tell this stuff is gonna come back to haunt me. Just like Bill and Monica. At some point, I'm gonna get in trouble and someone say, did you ever say that? Or just... No, I never. I'll be on the stand. No, I never, ever. All of a sudden, NFL Films will break out. We got them on tape.
Welcome to Wired for Sound. All the sounds our microphones picked up in 1998. And some we made up.
I'm going to show you this one more time. Memorize it. You got a circle there, a circle there, a circle there. You connect the three, tic-tac-toe. Now, who wants to challenge me? I haven't lost a game in 14 seasons.
We're doing a special piece on pregame conversation. The inanity, the nonsensical nature of pregame conversation. Right. And I thought this would be a great place to start.
Nonsensical?
Ask this one on the sideline about his hair.
Who's that?
Bill Kyle, Coach Kyle.
Oh, no.
He's losing it all. Right? He blames it all on me.
Every player, coach, and broadcaster in the NFL has his own unique game day perspective.
Big dogs are in the house!
You're killing me. Bob, you're actually killing me, man. I'm trying to get my game face on. You're up here singing.
I believe I can fly.
I can believe you're telling a lie.
Don't ever think you can't improve.
Never.
Tyrone.
There's always room for improvement.
Always room for improvement.
Even when you're 38.
Well, I mean, not like... I got a lot of room for improvement. Just don't ever let your mind go through that you don't want to improve. It's not that you can't. What'd you say? 35, sucker.
I want to introduce my fellow Mr. Sophisticate, Kevin Green.
Watch it. No cup. No cup. I've been telling him that might happen. He don't listen to me, though.
Can you believe they pay us to do this? Look at this.
Oh, man. I've always wanted to be a quarterback.
Who's our head ref today?
Cody Correnti. This is his rookie year.
Oh, we're going to give him some.
Hey, man. All right. You got tape stuck to your ass. You're like a donkey.
Hey, we friends now, but when that bell runs, we ain't friends no more.
Steve, I'll put you back. I'll put you back.
Away from you.
As game time draws near, everyone's focus becomes clearer.
Ina mina maya mo. Catch a fella by his hope. At the hollers, let it go.
Let's go, let's go, let's go.
All right.
play with a heart, play with some emotion. We'll come out on top. We gotta play hard.